I'm very happy that the ambassador of India, Madam Rinat Sandhu, she kindly agreed to attend this ceremony. As you, I'm sure all of you have heard the name of Ramanujan. You've probably seen his movie, The Man Who Knew Infinity. And he was quite, he has made such far-seeing contributions to mathematics. I mean, many of the works that he did 100 years ago, things like how to partition, the number of ways to partition an integer was one of his very favorite problems, as well as things like what is known as the Hardy-Ramanujan expansion. And also he introduced some very interesting new functions called the Mach theta functions. And quite surprisingly, 100 years later, these ideas are finding their way in remote areas of physics, like quantum field theory, in string theory, even in my own work in quantum black holes. Suddenly you encounter Ramanujan's work. So that is sort of kind of attests to the power and depth of his ideas, that 100 years later people find them useful in very different areas. So the Ramanujan Prize was basically created to honor, so therefore Ramanujan is one of the, you would say, the greatest, one of the greatest mathematical geniuses to come from the developing world. And the Ramanujan Prize was instituted to recognize the contributions of young mathematicians from developing countries. The prize is usually given to a mathematician under 45. And it is in collaboration with the International Mathematical Union, ICTP, and the Department of Science and Technology from India. And these three organizations have their members on the selection committee. And each year they select a brilliant or promising mathematician from the developing world. And this year we are very happy that Dr. Pham has been the recipient of this, is going to be the recipient of this year's medal. So with these opening remarks, I will request Madam Sandhu to say a few words. You should be able to.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be in Trieste today. It's a beautiful sunny day. My first visit to Trieste and first time at the ICTP. It's a wonderful occasion as well, the Ramanujan Prize. I think Dr. Dabolkar has already explained the relevance and the importance of this award, and that it is in the memory of one of the greatest mathematical geniuses of our times. I want to congratulate the winner of the award this year, that is Dr. Hoàng Hiệp Phạm from Vietnam, from the Institute of Mathematics at the Academy of Sciences and Technology of Vietnam in Hanoi. So it's a great pleasure to be here when he's receiving the award. He's very young, and I hope that his work and his contribution will inspire other young mathematicians to also follow in the steps of bringing their, their knowledge and their genius to all of us, and which benefits, in fact, all humanity. So congratulations very much on winning the award. Dr. Dabolkar has shared some very interesting facts and figures about India's collaboration with the ICTP over the years. And I'm very happy that that ICTP, which has been contributing so much to the growth of scientific expertise in developing countries, that India has also been able to participate, both contribute as well as be a recipient itself of the knowledge base and the facilities and the capacity building that is provided by this important institute. According to the figure he has shared, India is at the top of the list of countries for visiting scientists to ICTP in 2018. Last year, 328 Indians participated in the ICTP programs. Since 1970, more than 10,000 visitors from India have been at the ICTP, and in the last decade, 24% of the Indian women have been Indian visitors have been women. And since 1983, 16 of the prestigious ICTP prize winners have been from India. So it's you know, it's a kind of has been a very I should say a nurturing and a very helpful collaboration, where scientists from India have benefited greatly from this collaboration. I understand that many of them have gone on to receive many more awards and hold important positions in academic and scientific institutions. I have actually received a message from the Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, for Dr. Pham, which they've asked me to read here, a message of congratulations from India. So I shall read it for you. I congratulate Professor Hoàng Hiệp Phạm, Institute of Mathematics, Vietnam Academy of Science and Technology, for being awarded the prestigious Ramanujan Prize for the year 2019. The award is a recognition of your work and contribution in the field of complex analysis, and in particular, the pluripotential theory, which has been important, which have important applications in algebraic and complex Kähler geometry. The award also recognizes your important organizational role in advancement of mathematics in your country. It is also a great honor that the award has been instituted in the name of S. Ramanujan, the great Indian mathematician. I'm sure that your contribution will contribute to enlarge the legacy of the great Ramanujan. I'm also sure that this recognition will motivate you further to expand your research with more noteworthy outcomes in the future. It will also inspire researchers and young mathematicians, not only in your country, but in the entire developing world, to undertake research in mathematical sciences. I wish you all the best for your future endeavors. From Mr. Ashutosh Sharma, Secretary, Department of Science and Technology. Thank you very much for having me here, and wish you all the best. Thank you.
Okay, so now. Yeah, please. So now, I request Professor Bracci from.
So I am Carlos Koenig. I'm the president of the IME.
It's good to be in
IME. And it's my pleasure to congratulate Hoàng Hiệp Phạm from the Institute of Mathematics of the Vietnamese Academy of Sciences for his being awarded the Ramanujan Prize for his impressive work in complex geometry. The Ramanujan Prize is awarded by DST, ICTP, and the IMU. Thank you very much.
Yeah, sorry, that was a message from the International Mathematical Union representative. Now I request Professor Filippo Bracci. Actually, unfortunately, these terminals here are not working, so it's probably better we sit there. Just today, just 5 minutes ago, they stopped working, so apparently. Okay, so he will talk about pluripotential theory.
So first of all, I would like to thank very much ICTP. I'm very honored to be here to give this special lecture on pluripotential theory. I also congratulate with Dr. Pham for getting this prize. And I have to say, as a mathematician, that the name of Ramanujan is one of those names which reminds of magic and beautiful in mathematics. And also show, I mean, mathematicians, when they start working, they get accustomed to name of all over the world. And we don't have really frontiers or barrier in mathematics. We try to cooperate all together just for the sake of knowledge and to go in advance on difficult problems. So I'm very happy also for being here for the Ramanujan Prize. I myself have collaborators from India, from the Indian Institute of Technology of Science. One was visiting me a couple of months ago. So I'm very happy for this. Okay, let's come to the talk. First of all, I have to apologize because probably for mathematicians the talk would be too easy. For non-mathematicians, that probably that would be too difficult or even boring. So I'm sorry, but I try to do my best to calibrate. So, pluripotential theory. I want to give at least to those who are not mathematicians an idea of why we use this strange word or why people are considering this object. The most simple things that you can have is just a line. And the function like this is linear. So linear is something very easy. You would like that everything would be linear, but that's not in reality. And then, you say, okay, linear is not enough everywhere, essentially. And you can have, in physical phenomena, in reality, you have phenomena which are very far from being linear. In fact, most of the nowadays phenomena are even fractals, so it's something very, very complicated. But that's too much. That's too complicated. We don't have the appropriate technology to understand. So you can say, well, instead of linear, you might consider something which is some kind of sublinear. So it's what mathematicians call a convex function. What's the main property of this of a convex function? Well, if you take any 2 points in this figure and you consider the line joining these 2 points, this line here is always above this one. And that's essentially the main philosophy which is underneath plurisubharmonic function and pluripotential theory. So it's something which is complicated enough to include or to be good to determine or to study many phenomena that come from physics or from natural science, but still they are not too complicated. So we can somehow work on that. So I gave some definition, mathematical definition. So I start from the very basic object is a upper semi-continuous function is a function from a certain domain in Rn on the real line, such that all sub-level sets are open. So you probably know, I mean, just by heart, that when you talk about continuous function means that you can draw a picture without taking out your hand from the blackboard. And here, upper semi-continuous means that, okay, it's not continuous, but almost. It tend. You would like to be to pretend to be continuous, although it is not. And the main one, I think the very beautiful result, and one of the probably the guiding result of all the theory, is this that we call maximum principle. This means that if you have this upper semi-continuous function, so that's just a technical matter, and suppose that you have this function defined on some domain which satisfies this inequality. So this inequality here means essentially that if you take a ball and you consider this function on the ball, so here you can imagine a graph above this this ball here, and you measure the area or the volume of this object, then it is always greater than the value in the center when you divide by the volume of the ball itself. And if this happens, then the function cannot have maximum inside. You can think more or less about this case here. You can have this picture, and this picture essentially contain all my talk. So if you are in this situation, you see that the maximum is reached here. It cannot be reached here. Okay. People define this special class of function to be subharmonic. So subharmonic are functions that, aside this kind of strange regularity, they have this submean property. And if you have a function which is both subharmonic and the minus the function is also subharmonic, then this is called harmonic. You can think of here. So you have this function here, and if you take the negative of this function, then you get something which is concave, so in the other side. But if you have a function which is convex, and when you take minus, it still stay convex, then you see that the only possibility is to be the line. So somehow, harmonic function are a better subharmonic function. In fact, in mathematical terms, they are analytic, which means that they have a lot of regularity. They can expand in Taylor series. And, well, there is this symbol. As a mathematician, I am forced to use symbol, which is called the Laplacian. So the Laplacian is just this object, which means that you take the function. Well, the function, we assume for the moment, as I said, if it's harmonic, you can prove that it's analytic. So in particular, you take the second derivative with respect to all the variables. You take the sum, and you call this operator is the Laplace operator. And then the function is harmonic if and only if it satisfies this equation. Now, subharmonic function and harmonic function, they are very, very important in applications. For instance, electric and gravitational potentials, diffusion equation for heat and fluid dynamics and flows, wave propagation, quantum mechanics, they are all based on equations which are based essentially on this operator here, the Laplacian. So if you want to apply any kind of mathematics, most of the time you will find yourself dealing with this guy. Okay, and this is what usually mathematicians call potential theory. Now just to give an idea of this, so a function u is subharmonic, and then it has this is another submean property that instead of dealing with volume, you deal with the surface of the ball. But that's a technical part. But the most interesting is exactly that it acts like the linear function. So if you have a subharmonic function, if you take any other function is subharmonic, whenever, if you take any harmonic function which has the same value or a bigger value on the boundary, then the subharmonic functions stay behind. So it's like linear and convex. That's exactly the same, except that here is a little bit more complicated. So there is this idea of subharmonic, the word sub, which means stay under harmonic function and satisfy this maximum principle. Okay, this probably is too technical. You can prove that if you have a subharmonic function, this is locally integrable, and it satisfies the same equation as before, but this time with greater or equal than zero. And conversely, you can prove that that equation is essentially enough. Okay, I will skip probably this too technical part. Here is the same as we said before, that if you have something linear, it means that it stays above any other linear function. And here is exactly the same. If you have a subharmonic function, then it is harmonic if and only if it stays above any other subharmonic function which is bigger on the boundary. And then this is what I was saying, that harmonic functions are maximal subharmonic functions. Okay, that's the way, I mean, probably you heard this name, Dirichlet problem, which is another kind of differential equation that one tried to solve to construct certain objects. Okay, now I will be a little bit more technical just to understand from a mathematical point of view how to move from the real world, because what I said now is essentially real, to the complex world. You know that here I wrote in CN, but just consider the plane or the real number and the complex number. So you know that complex number can be multiplied by I. If you consider a complex number as a sum of a real plus I imaginary part, so a couple of numbers, that means that you stay in a plane. And then the multiplication by I becomes what we call a linear operator that here I define by J. This J here, which is just a multiplication. So you multiply the original complex number by I. Now you look in terms of real variable. And that's exactly what you would do if you consider this vector as this complex number as a real couple of real numbers and multiply by this operator here. Okay. In complex analysis, the main object to study, are those so-called holomorphic functions. So this term comes from Latin and means same form, essentially, which are because holomorphic function, at least those in dimension one, are those who preserve from an infinitesimal point of view the form. So if you have a circle, it cannot be deformed. It's continue to be a circle. And here you can use this operator, J, to say analytically what means that the function is holomorphic. Okay, now I need to introduce these two operators, which I call D and D bar, and they are defined formally in this way. So essentially, this du means that you take the differential of the function, or in non-too technical term, you try to approximate your function by using, if you have this curve here, at this point you try to approximate with something linear. And that's essentially the meaning of this du in the formula. And now you take this this operator J, because this it's a real object, and you multiply by I. And so you do the same here, but you put plus instead of minus. Okay, that's of course there is a reason why one does this, because provides a so-called C-linear and see antilinear decomposition of the differential of u, which means, C-linear means that if you multiply first by a complex number, then this complex number gets out from the differential. And see antilinear is the same for, conjugation. Okay, and then you can define also this operator DC, which is here is the analytical formula. And again, you can play a little bit with these terms, and you see that the function, if you write in terms of real and complex part, real and imaginary part, this comes holomorphic if and only if they satisfy this relation. So for the moment, it's just playing with some strange objects. And now here comes an important part, which is the complexation of a matrix, which means essentially that you take, instead of considering just a real differentiation, you differentiate with respect to Z and Z bar. And this is called the complexation. And now the operator, the Laplacian that we saw before, this becomes four times the trace of this complex matrix. Well, that's an Hermitian matrix, something more. Okay, another object is the so-called Levy form. And the Levy form is technically is a 0-2 tensor. And it's defined in this way. So you take the complex Hessian of a function, and then you define this quadratic form in this way. So what you see now is that if you restrict the function to a line, a complex line, and you compute the Laplacian, you get the Levy form applied to the vector of this direction. And this suggests the following definition, that you say that the function is pluriharmonic if, whenever you restrict to a slice, the function is harmonic. So harmonic was exactly the same definition as before. So now we are, just try to move away with hands, we are in the space. And so we can look at all the figure, or we can slice up and see what happens on the slice. And that's what we do in this context. And then by the previous formula, you see that the function is pluriharmonic if and only if the Levy form is identically vanishing. Okay, so in particular, the pluriharmonic function are analytic, and the Levy form vanishing identically. And they are also harmonic by the same reason, because if the Levy form is identically zero, then the trace is identically zero, but the converse is not true. And in fact, one can characterize a pluriharmonic function by saying that it's a function which is locally the real part or the imaginary part of a holomorphic function. So even if you didn't get anything about what I said, the main point here is that the potential theory, the Laplacian and so on, is good to work with a real problem. But when you are in the complex world, and many, even at least the theoretical problems, are modeling using the complex language, the complex function, so there, the Laplacian is not good. So we need something else. And that something else is exactly this definition of pluri. So when you heard about pluripotential, pluriharmonic, plurisubharmonic, means that it's about the same as here, except that you are in the complex world. That's the philosophy. The point is that the trace of the Hessian is not invariant. If you change coordinate holomorphically, it's not invariant, it changes. So if you have a function which is harmonic and you change coordinate, then you take the function, it's no longer harmonic in that coordinates. But if you have an harmonic function which stay harmonic under holomorphic change of coordinate, then it's pluriharmonic. So it's something which is really well related to the complex world. Okay, since we have the notion of harmonic, subharmonic, we have the notion of pluriharmonic, and we can have the notion of plurisubharmonic. So a PSH or plurisubharmonic function is a function which, when you restrict to this slice as before, now is no longer harmonic, but it's subharmonic, or minus infinity, but that's a technical detail. Okay, and then if the function is regular enough, you can use the same operator as before, the Levy form, and you see that a condition, a necessary and sufficient condition for a function to be plurisubharmonic is this one, that the Levy form is positive semi-definite. Okay, this is a technical definition. And again, plurisubharmonic functions are a class of subharmonic functions, but they are not the same. because of the same reason. And here is essentially the same property. Subharmonic function, which is plurisubharmonic if it is so under any change of holomorphic coordinates. And this, which might be important for Dr. Pham next talk, is that this allowed to define plurisubharmonic function on complex manifold. So complex manifold, you can, when you heard the word manifold, means that you have the ambient space, which is our space or complex affine space, and you patch together part of this in a certain way. So you construct objects which cannot be in general embedded in our world, but they still exist. And then you want to understand what are the objects living on there, and then, I mean, you have to be able to define them. And because of this observation, you can really do. Okay, then you have that in some manifold, for instance, if the manifold is compact, there are no global plurisubharmonic function because of the maximum principle, is where compact means that you have a hand somewhere. So in this picture, if you try to go at infinity, but then you know that you can glue, then you lose convexity somewhere. And that happens more or less here. And okay, that's another technical point that somehow, even if it's not too regular, you can manage to have a regular plurisubharmonic function. And okay, here is another characterization using the so-called currents, but probably I'm asking too much to understand this, but it's this DDCU is a 1-1 form if U is regular, which is constructed by the previous D and DC, and this is going to be a positive 1-1 form. And that's very important because this part here is related to the so-called Kähler manifold and so on, where you really use going to study this this object and curvature and so on. Okay. Yeah, then we have a maximal function. As we said before, the harmonic function are maximal in the class of subharmonic function. That's unfortunately is not true in general for plurisubharmonic function. If you have a plurisubharmonic function, which is maximal, is not in general pluriharmonic. And this is what Sadullah have defined as a maximal plurisubharmonic function, which is a plurisubharmonic function which has the property of being above any other plurisubharmonic function for which it is above on the boundary. And as I said, they are not in general pluriharmonic. But what you might see is that if you have a proper holomorphic embedding at each point in such a way that the restriction of your function is harmonic, then this is maximal. So somehow harmonicity is included in some sense. And then there is this operator, which is the so-called complex Monge-Ampère operator, and that became very famous after the Calabi conjecture and Yau results, which is essentially this operator here. So you remember, maybe you don't, but this form, 1-1 form, DDCU, which this is U, which is, if you make a computation, is just a determinant, essentially, of this complex action that we defined before. And that's the so-called complex Monge-Ampère operator. And you see that if it is plurisubharmonic, then the determinant, so in particular, this operator here is always greater or equal than zero. And if it is maximal, then this operator is zero. So you might try to solve in an analytic way this problem by considering not the Laplacian, but this complex Monge-Ampère operator. Okay, and as I said, by definition, if you have this complex Hermitian form, you take the determinant. This is zero if and only if there is one eigenvector, which is one eigenvector related to one zero eigenvalue. And so in particular, this means that at every point you have such condition. You have a privileged direction. And in fact, if you have a kind of foliation, which is an object meaning that at each point you can prescribe a certain direction in such a way that your function restricted to this foliation is harmonic, then the function is maximal. And the converse is also true. I mean, if you have a maximal plurisubharmonic function with some regularity. Then there exists a Monge-Ampère foliation, which means that you can foliate, you can divide your manifold in leaves in such a way that the restriction of your function on these leaves are harmonic. And this is called the Monge-Ampère foliation. As I said, there was probably you heard this Dirichlet problem, which means that you study you look for an harmonic function, so you study Laplacian equal to zero with some prescribed boundary data, and this comes this kind of problem comes in many physical phenomena, as I said. Here you can consider the same kind of problem, but now considering the complex Monge-Ampère operator. So you look essentially for a maximal plurisubharmonic function which has a prescribed boundary data. And in fact, you can solve this problem in reasonable case. And you have the so-called Perron-Bremerman function, which means the following. It's very natural. You consider all plurisubharmonic function which has the property of being less when you go to the boundary than the data that you have on the boundary. So here, for instance, just consider this case. You want to, you give some value, this value and this value, and you want to find a function possibly which is linear and attains these two values here. And of course you can do, it's just this straight line. But now the idea is, I don't know if I can do, but I know that there are a lot of these convex functions which stay here behind. And then at each point, I take the maximum as possible. And then you see that if you do this picture here, you just go to the line. And here you do the same, essentially, but using this kind of objects. So this pluripotential theory has been used. Klimek introduced the so-called pluricomplex Green function. Green function is something that if you study mathematics, but even problem of physics, it comes naturally. And here is the pluri version of this Green function. So you do exactly the same game as before. You consider a domain, you consider all negative plurisubharmonic function, but now you assume that to have a logarithmic singularity inside. So you have something which now has a prescribed singularity. And you see that it has some good property that I'm just going to skip briefly. But mainly what is important is that, you see, you want to, the main object of study morally would be holomorphic function, but these are too complicated and too rigid. So you pass to study this plurisubharmonic function. It's exactly like here. You want somehow to approximate or using linear function, but they are too rigid, and then you allow to use convex. And here you do the same. But now you see that this kind of function, pluricomplex Green function has good property because if you have holomorphic map, then it is almost preserved, it is reduced. So this gives information, in fact. Okay, and then if you have a domain bounded, then you can really find such a solution, such a function, which is also maximal and satisfy this complex Monge-Ampère equation. And then if you have some other condition like this called hyperconvexity, then still again you can prove some more regularity condition, and Demaillé in fact show that there exists, and it is also a unique solution to this kind of generalized Dirichlet problem for the complex Monge-Ampère equation. I won't spend too much time here because I think it's too technical. There is this function here, however, is related also to a special metric which is called the Kobayashi distance, which is very natural in, it's not the Euclidean, so to go from here to here, probably I don't have to go straight, but maybe I have to turn and go there, and that's still the shortest way. So it's another distance, but it's very natural. And this function here is pretty much related to this distance. Okay, and then I just wanted to mention that you can do the same game at the boundary, and you can define a pluricomplex Poisson function, which I defined some 10 years ago, maybe more, with Giorgio Patrizio and Stefano Trapani, where now you assume that your function, you consider the family of plurisubharmonic function negative, which has a kind of a simple pole when you go non-tangentially to the boundary. And in the unit disk, this is really the Poisson kernel. Probably you heard this name. Okay, and again, it has many good properties, this kind of function. It has you still have a solution, which is essentially unique, although we don't know exactly if it is unique, of a kind of a generalized Dirichlet problem. And again, it has very special property. If you look to the level set, they turns out to be the so-called orosphere. And it allows to get a reproducing formula for plurisubharmonic function. In fact, even for plurisubharmonic function, but here I just mentioned this one. So essentially means that you have your boundary data, and you want to reconstruct the entire function. And you can do if you have a reproducing formula. And this kind of kernel, this kind of solution, allows to reconstruct the entire function by starting from a boundary data problem. Okay, and that's, I think this was my last slice. I hope I was not bored. And thank you very much for your attention.
So I request Professor Arezzo to now give a presentation about the work of this. You prefer? Yes. Okay.
Well, while we solve the technical problems, first of all, let me thanks a lot Filippo Bracci, good friend of ICTP, and for giving a very gentle and clear introduction to some of the most technical parts of mathematics that I know. So, and we will see.
Right.
That's it.
Forward, backwards.
Perfect. Okay. And also, I really also on behalf of the mathematics section as a subset of the whole of ICTP, but I'm really very grateful to the ambassador, Your Excellency, the ambassador, to be here for us. The name of Srinivasa Ramanujan is ubiquitous in mathematics, as we all know, but actually it was not planned, but just by accident, we just finished a special section, set of lectures by Professor Don Zagier, who works with us for a few months per year on the Rogers Ramanujan identities, and I mean, just four beautiful lectures. I mean, his work is still with us. Strange enough, I will mention another Ramanujan, which is less famous, but as a geometer, I would say almost with the same level of geniality, unfortunately with a similar sad story, personal story. Anyway, my role now is just to introduce you. Thanks, Filippo, for introducing the general area of research of the winner of this year. I introduce the person. So I give you some information about the work of Professor Pham. So few bio data. I hope I'm not violating any privacy, but so he's well below our limit age for the Ramanujan Prize. He's very young, also for among young scientists, he's very young. I mean, and he has studied bachelor and master in Hanoi, got his PhD in Sweden. He has taken few postdoctoral positions in Europe, in Italy, and France, before going back to Vietnam, where he's now professor at the Institute of Mathematics at the Vietnamese Academy of Science. Sorry for the question mark, I just solved the problem. Since 2018, but actually I have to apologize for either he has been promoted, I knew him as the deputy director, my fault, he's actually the director of the UNESCO Center in Hanoi, so he's a good collaborator of ICTP also in many other in other directions, and in fact we are working together as UNESCO team. Okay, he also got some important recognitions in Vietnam for his work. Coming, I mean, of course I don't expect you to read this page, it's just a small sample of his mathematical production. I counted 38, could be more, sorry, but I mean, at least greater than or equal to 38 papers in international journals, and these are just a sample. You can see some of the most distinguished journals appearing here. in the mathematical community. And of course, you will start seeing the word pluripotential, Monge-Ampère, and that's why Filippo has been kind enough to explain to us a bit what they mean, because that's where he has been working on. So the main research themes, I would say, are probably related to three areas: existence and regularity of solutions of complex Monge-Ampère equations. Filippo told us a little bit what is this problem about. The more generally, properties of singularities of plurisubharmonic functions, because the key point is that plurisubharmonic functions tend to be very singular. I mean, Filippo could not dig too much into the technicalities, but I mean, the point is that they tend to go to minus infinity a bit too often than we hope. And when they do, we want to understand what does it mean and what do they measure. The rate of singularity in this language means going to minus infinity, essentially. So what does it mean for something like that? But I'm a geometer, so in fact, that's why I asked a good friend, a complex analyst, to explain the first two, because I'm in love with the third line, because that's really where pluripotential theory, which is, I think, branch of complex analysis, comes to speak with geometry. Okay, now it's a very strange history, and this ceremony is also live streamed outside ICTP. I hope I'm not offending, because I could not trace, and I think nobody, it's not really known where this log LCT stands for, log canonical threshold. This number was born for sure in many papers, more or less at the same time, at the end of the 60s and the 70s. Somebody claims it was Atiyah the first one to define it, but it was essentially contained with small variations in paper by Lelong, by Skoda, by Siu, and so on. The point is, taking a plurisubharmonic function phi, you want to know which is the least, the least, because it's a minus. Otherwise, if you put the minus in front of the exponent, is the soup of the exponents you have to put when you exponentiate it to make this function integrable. So remember, we are dealing with the problem of going to minus infinity. So that's why as a log, the log is the thing that we have in mind. So we exponentiate it in order to make it treatable, and then we work like that. Now, for any function, you define this number. This is called the complex integrability exponent. The main situation where you actually see in geometry appearing this is when actually this function is not just any function, but is actually the norm squared of the section of a bundle. Okay? Let me just say it like that. So it appears in geometry because when your function is not just a generic function, but it's really the section of the holomorphic section of a line bundle, I mean, the norm of a holomorphic section of a line bundle, then you're really speaking about the log canonical threshold of the pair of the complex manifold X and the zero locus of the section, which is what we call a divisor. Anyway, these two numbers appeared essentially at the same time in a number of papers, and the point I just want to make is this. Sorry for the technological, I could not draw it in a more fancy way, so I did it by hand, but the point is, these numbers, as I said, defined more or less 50 years ago, now they are still a big mystery. I mean, in the sense that they have been used and they have helped to solve problems in all branches of mathematics, I would say. The problem is, they appeared, I mean, even the most surprising one, if you now think this is just complex analysis, for example, Iguza, in a very famous paper of 1977, found essentially this number has the rate of growth of solutions over z mod a prime to some power of a polynomial with integer coefficients. Okay, so purely number theory. Kähler, 20 years later, invariants of singularities and Bernstein polynomials. I don't know where you would put it in the geography of mathematics, whether topology or, again, number theory or the intersection of the two. A bit more classical, and actually probably what made everything very famous, was essentially these numbers appearing in the famous classification of algebraic surfaces in characteristic P. We all know that Kodaira, Enriquez, and Severi classified algebraic surfaces in characteristic zero. That's the famous Kodaira Enriquez classification. But then, 30 years later, more or less, Manford and Bombieri gave the classification in characteristic P, and actually, again, this number played a closure rule in their work. Based on an idea which goes back essentially to the birth of these numbers, of the log canonical threshold by Iskovsky and Manin, then through the works of Puklikov, then essentially Alessio Corti, much more recently, applied again the theory related to these numbers to the problem of studying the rationality of Fano varieties, that if you are an algebraic geometer, you probably consider one of the central problems in algebraic geometry. Rationality means whether an algebraic variety is actually biolomorphic to Pn, birational to P, to the complex projective space. Okay, so that's a kind of stays to algebraic geometry like the Poincaré conjecture stays to topology. I mean, you really want to know, I mean, is this manifold trivial or not? Okay. Algebraic geometers call it to be rational. Okay. Then, as I said, the other Ramanujan, the other famous Ramanujan, CP Ramanujan, in the beginning of the 70s, actually, again, used these numbers to open a line which actually was very fertile in the years to come. Lazarsfeld, many, many people worked on that to realize that these actually good estimates on these numbers could provide good vanishing theorems, which in geometry are very good. Vanishing means vanishing for cohomology. I mean, if every time a group is zero, you open a bottle. I mean, you are happy because something is easy, finally. Okay? And then probably, again, another fundamental, this is actually direct application of the study of these numbers was given by Tian right after his PhD thesis. Basically, the Tian's theorem is probably the easiest here to quote almost correctly, in the sense that if you can prove that this number, when you take the anti-canonical divisor, is sufficiently big, then actually that means that your space is actually Einstein. That's Tian's theorem. So there is an actually precise bound that if you can exceed that, then your space is an Einstein space. So for theoretical of positive curvature, I mean, that's where the problem really stays. So as you can see, I mean, this is just, if you want, just psychology. But as I said, the work of this year's winner is very technical and goes really to the heart, to the center of this picture. Now, the problem is, if you prove a great theorem at the center, presumably you can imagine some kind of earthquakes in the surrounding, no? And in fact, I would like just to finish this, my little presentation of Pham's work, just by quoting what is probably the most, at least, I mean, for a geometer, for sure, for a geometer, this is really a great theorem that he proved in collaboration with De Mailly. Because, you see, you can really look down to the bottom. I mean, the idea here, you want to have an estimate on the complex integrability exponent of any plurisubharmonic function. I mean, here it's normalized just to be the origin, the bed point. And you see, well, this is telling us, I mean, what De Mailly and Pham are telling us is that this is greater or equal to this rather simple expression. But the point is that not this expression is simple. The point is that this expression is actually, these numbers are actually defined here. And now, okay, of course, we don't have the time to go into details, but I mean, these are cohomological numbers related to the function phi. So basically, the geometry is completely dominating the problem, and in principle, computable. Plus, the fact that, I mean, this is the end of probably 40 years of work by many, many people. I mean, there were estimates of various type. The point is that they also prove that this is sharp. So it's as good as it gets. Okay, you can construct easily examples where this is an equality and not an inequality. Okay, so I think, now you put, for example, this kind of theorems back in the previous page, and you can imagine that this has corollaries in all directions. And I think, at least one way to to congratulate again Dr. Pham for the prize and to convince you that this is absolutely very, very well deserved. And my congratulations. Okay, so now actually this is the moment of the award. I was jumping to your lecture, but so now if you can come here and we should stand there. We do the unboxing as now it's very popular on. Oops. Oh, I didn't remove the. Give the statue. I give the this, or you want to do? I give this, and you give that.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay. So. Okay, so this is the price, and so now we are very happy to leave the winners on the stage for special lectio magistralis
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for a nice introduction. Before presenting my talk, I will say some words. I have watched a movie about the Indian great mathematician Srinivasa Ramanujan, the brilliant sage. I am impressed by his own life and his great contribution to mathematics. Therefore, I am very happy and proud to receive the prize. Let me thank the ICTP, DST, and IMU for organizing the prize. And so many thanks all people here, and many thanks to all former advisor, and all my collaborator, and all my colleagues. And finally, I would like to express my deep gratitude to my parents who always support and encourage me to pursue my career. Now I will talk about the singularity of two solid functions in corporate analysis and the emergency. In this talk, we decipher how to combine the techniques of complex Monge-Ampère operator and deep by equation with Antoine statement to obtain some results in the theory of singularity and related application in corporate analysis and the emergency. Finally, we present a question and a quadrature in this topic. First, I will give a short, very short introduction to corpuscular analysis and geometry. As we know, corpuscular analysis in one variable is a class of mathematical analysis that investigates the function of complex numbers. It was developed by many mathematicians such as Cauchy, Euler, Gauss, and Mittag-Leffler, Riemann, very sharp in the 18th century. It is useful in many parts of mathematics, including algebraic, geometry, number theory, analytics, combinatory, dynamical system, applied mathematics, model fields of physics. And I will say some more about the corpuscular analysis of several variables. Corpuscular analysis of several variables is the study of function fz1 dot dot zn, with z1 zn is in domain in Cn. It was first introduced by and studied by Kaitang, Groes, Hastok, Zemes, Stens, Oka, and Turan in the 19th century. It is connected to other fields of mathematics, including algebraic, geometry, functional analysis, Bessel's differential equation, commutative algebraic, measure theory, and dynamical system. I will introduce the complex manifolds and complex vector bundle. A complex manifold is the topological space. It's with some neighborhood of every boy is a homomorphic to an upper subset of Cn, such that the transition between the three open sets as given by Hanoi function and complex vector bundle. On complex manifold is a vector bundle, Zin vector bundle, whose fibers are complex vector space and transition function as Hanoi function. And we talk about the space of Hanoi function. And let E be a complex vector bundle over a complex manifold X, we denote S0 XE. By the set of own Hanoi function of E over X, a fundamental problem in complex analysis and geometry is to construct Hanoi function in S0 XE such that decider condition. Here we have a remark here. If it is a trivial bundle of Zanka, then S0XE is a space of Hanoi maps from X to CK. Then I will give a short introduction to a Hanoi function and analysis survivability. Net omega be a complex manifold of dimension n, and a function f from omega to c is said to be holomorphic on omega. If for every boy c 0 in omega, then f equal power series on the neighborhood of 0. And we define omega defined by own of holomorphic function on omega, and o 0 denoted by own Hanoi function groups at a boy ZSO. That as we know, the ring ZSO is a unique factorization and Noetherian. As we are always assume that omega is complex manifold of dimension n, and a subset A of omega is set analytic. If for every boy ZSO in omega, we have I intersection U equal exactly Z in U, such that F1Z equal dot dot FMZ equal 0, where F1FM is a Hanoi function on U. And the subset A of Cn is said to be algebraic if there exists polynomials F1FM, such that A equals Z in Cn, such that F1Z equal dot dot FMZ equal 0. A subset R of projective space, CPN, is said to be algebraic if there exists homogeneous polynomial f1 fm such that I equal z1 z m plus 1 such that f1 z m plus 1 equal fm z1 z m plus 1 equal 0. By this Zhou held up, we know that every analytic subvariety in a primitive space CPN is algebraic. Now I will introduce about plurisubharmonic function. Thank you very much for a nice lecture. Professor Filippo Bracci, he talked very clear about this function. With an upper semicondular function phi from omega to minus infinity plus infinity defined on the domain omega is Cn, it's going to be plurisubharmonic if phi z less than this number. It's average of value phi z plus cw with mod c of less than I, r. And we define the BSS omega be denoted by the set of plurisubharmonic function and PSF minus to be own plurisubharmonic function negative on omega. Here we have some example. We have a first own convex function as plurisubharmonic and own plurisubharmonic as subharmonic. Of course, we know that every convex function as continuous, even Lipschitz. But plurisubharmonic function is not continuous as second example. We take F1 Fm be a holomorphic function on omega, and it takes phi z equal logar modulus F1z 2 power 2 plus dot dot plus F1z 2 power 2. Then we have F5, the function phi is plurisubharmonic, and we have the set z in omega such that phi z equal minus infinity equal z in omega such that F1z equal fmz equals 0. Then we have this set is a variety in omega. But in Pluripotential Theory, this set is a Pluripotential set. Here we talk about we have some connection between the idea in the ring O0 with plurisubharmonic function. We take idea I is the ring O0, and for every basic F1 Fm of EI. And we set phi z equal 1 divided 2 logar F1 z 2 by 2 plus Fm z 2 by 2. That phi is plurisubharmonic function on U. And we take z1 zk be another basic of the I and E. As such, says Cz equal 1 divided 2 logar f z1 z2 by 2 plus zk z2 by 2. We have a different plurisubharmonic function phi and psi. However, phi minus psi is bounded on the neighborhood of u of 0. It means that phi and psi have the same singularity as 0. Then we can use the function phi to understand the I and E. Now I will give a short introduction about the current and interesting theory. Different form has parts of different geometry influenced by linear algebra. It was introduced by Kachtang in 1899. We did not the D0 key omega with a set of different form of DK whose coefficient be not smooth function with support in omega. And the current of degree key or dimension n minus key in the sense of real theorem is complex continuous linear function on space of compactly supported differential form. Then, in a geometric setting, they can that is an integration over submanifold generalizing the Dirac measure by the boy. Many designs of integration theory is still applied to colors. Here we give some notation in the Pluripotential Theory about the non-negative current and the Zin current. Here we have some remarks. We take the T be closed and non-negative current of degree 1, 1, then T equal DDC phi, which phi is a Pluripotential function on omega. And it takes A is a closed analytic severity of poor dimension and minus P, tensor exists PP current of integration associated to A and is defined by this formula. It's iterated on the singularity of A. And it's easy to see that the current is non-negative. As top theorem implies, the current is closed. But DeLong has shown that the current is locally finite mass near the singularity point. And this follows this and can be studied as consequence of circular extension theorem. We talked about the web product of closed non-negative current and application. For fundamental works of the web product of closed non-negative current and application to iteration theory and corporate analysis and other place they emerge, we refer the reader to the articles of Urban Second and the Pandemic. He has some paper. So then the definition of the corporate Monge-Ampère operator and the pandemic Monge-Ampère operator length long numbers and iteration theory. And the pandemic a numerical criterion for every Ambo 9 bundle. And for recent works on the West product of closed non-negative current on corporate dynamic flow and application to iteration theory and corporate dynamics in higher dimension. We refer it to the Dinikov and Nishibuzi article. We have some article, regularization of current and entropy, and geometry of colors, and iteration theory and dynamics of horizontal line maps. And super potential of positive closed current, iteration theory and dynamics. Now we talk about the difference of corporate Monge-Ampère operator for smooth Pluripotential function. The classical potential theory plays an important zone. There is studies the Laplace linear operator. And in corporate analysis, instead of the Laplace operator, we consider the corporate Monge-Ampère nonlinear operator defined by follow DC 2 by N equal and the determiners of the complex Hessian of matrix complex Hessian function phi. And it is the Lebesgue measure. And DC 2 by N is the Zadon negative measure. But if the function is not smooth, we define the complex measure by if we assume that we assist a measure nu, it's called the complex Monge-Ampère operator of phi. If for every the open set D in omega, for every smooth sequence of smooth Pluripotential function phi z decreases to phi, then DDC phi z 2 by n convert to nu, which needs z to go up infinity. We denote we need for DDC phi to n by the complex Monge-Ampère operator of phi. In one dimension, the DDC phi equal Laplace operator is greatly phi for every subharmonic function. But in the case of higher dimension, we have many counter examples to show that the complex Monge-Ampère is not defined. For example, on the moon, we take the function phi equal logarithm moon z1. It's the complex Monge-Ampère of this function is not greatly phi by this meaning. you talked about some history of division of complex Monge-Ampère operator. In 1982, Bedford and Taylor proved that the complex Monge-Ampère operator is verified for class about the plurisubharmonic function. And later, that pandemic showed that the complex Monge-Ampère operator is verified for class with bounded value near the boundary. And it should be noted that this is still true for current and its many applications in interaction theory and complex dynamic system. And in Urban Section paper, he introduced and studied a general class of plurisubharmonic function on which the complex Monge-Ampère is well defined. He defined by class E omega. And he also introduced some class plurisubharmonic function EB omega and FP omega with finite energy, which are useful tools to show some pressure in complex analysis of several variables. And in the case of two dimension, we have E omega is equal plurisubharmonic function iteration where cap log 1-2 is the sublet space. And some correct Monge-Ampère equation on domain is some design. In the 1976, the complex Monge-Ampère equation on domain CN was first studied by fundamental works of Bedford and Taylor. And later, it has intensive developments by a series of paper mathematicians such as Urban Sakhan, Solikolazay, Nazon Lambert, Perham, Lafkis, and also myself. We have some. And here we talked about complex Monge-Ampère equation on compact Kähler manifold. Before we talk in local case, in global context, the complex Monge-Ampère equation appears naturally in problem of existing unique Kähler matrix in the same class we see form is any given two form that is presenting the first chain class on compact Kähler manifold. The solution of Calvi conjecture equivalent to the solution of Monge-Ampère equation on compact Kähler manifold by Situ in 1976, revolutionized complex differential geometry. And to this day, this is, has many consequences and is still an open of interpretation for current study. Since the complex Monge-Ampère equation have been useful tool in plurisubharmonic theory, complex geometry as an application to construct Kähler-Einstein matrix on compact Kähler manifold and numerical characterization of the Kähler cone of compact Kähler manifold. We see some paper of Philippe Asier, Vixen Get, Amazahi in 2009, Demi and Mikhail Poon in 2004, Sintoro in 78, and Gatian in 87. Here I talk about the Singularity design. He proves that net is omega p a compact Kähler manifold of dimension n. Assume that f is a smooth function such that iteration over f omega to n equal iteration over f omega to n. Then there exists a unique smooth omega plurisubharmonic function phi on x such that dz phi plus omega to n equal f omega to n. And sub phi on x equals 0. Now I will talk about the Debye equation with the two extremes in a basic convex domain. The solution of Debye equation with the two extremes domain was invented by Homander, and we also see the Ramanujan Prize in 97. Let omega be a special convex domain in CN. Assume that phi is plurisubharmonic on omega and AZ is a continuous map from omega to a set of negative Hermitian matrix such that DD bar phi class on A. And the volume of z in omega, the determinant az equals 0 equals 0. So for every 0, 1 form in N2, F, we suggest nibar F equals 0 and suggest this condition. Then there is, exists a function F U in N node 2, suggest nibar U equals F and suggest condition. It's a very nice form estimate here. You can use this. And they have a second version. When you touch the omega, is the domain is a subset of the bone. That we have a, the same with the same condition, f is 0, 1 form, such that d bar f equals 0, and such that condition. Then there exists a function u, such that d bar u equals f, and such that this condition. But, I will talk about the two extension theorem of Osawa and Takahashi. A useful consequence of Sony bivariation with the two extremes is N2 extension theorem of Osawa and Takahashi. It was a main tool in the proof of many fundamental results in corporate analysis and their merging. We take omega be a bounded basic convex domain in CN. F phi is plurisubharmonic function, and N is complex subspace. Then for every function, holomorphic function F on omega intersection N, then there exists holomorphic function F on whole domain omega, which iteration over omega moon F 2 by 2 is minus phi, the back measure, and then some constant depend on omega, iteration on omega intersection N, F 2 by 2, is 2 per minus 5, and the big measure on N. The C omega is only depend on the diameter of omega. The number C omega is not good in the Osawa and Takahashi paper. I think the C omega is 1,700, but he finds the best constant C omega here. We have omega in Cn minus 1 times d, is domain, and we have phi is plurisubharmonic function on omega, and f is a homing function on n intersection omega. Then we can by the function f to f on the Saksa condition with the best constant here. Now I will talk about the singularity of plurisubharmonic function in less phi is plurisubharmonic function, and the observed research of the singularity with the research or study the behavior of the function phi on neighborhood of phi equal minus infinity. And we use some tool here, corporate analysis of several variable method and debugging with the two estimates and the two extensions of Osawa Takahashi, corporate Monge-Ampère operator and invariant of singularity of plurisubharmonic function, boy as Nernst number and no canonical threshold. We talked about the Lelong number. It was introduced by Lelong. It measures the singularity of this function. We touch the Lelong number of plurisubharmonic function phi at the point z equal by definition. It means that we compare phi with local modulus of w minus z at the point z. It's the constant Lelong number of z. It's introduced by Lelong. Here we have some property of Lelong number. First, we take the f be a holomorphic function, then the Lelong number of logamun f of z equal multiplicity of f at the boy z. And we take the ideal I of the ring for basic f1 fm of the ideal I, which says phi z equal
1 divided 2 log f1 z2 power 2 plus
dot 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 plus
fm z2 power 2. Then the number 5 at 0 is minimum multiplicity of f1 at 0 multiplicity fm at 0.
Then now I talk about some a very beautiful design of Int'l cell by saying that the function from z to the number 5z is upper semi-continuous with respect analytics that gives the topology. This was conjectured by Hevey and King in 1972, and it's proved by Int'l cell in the paper. And the simple proof of Sil theorem was founded by Zabademi, who devised an approximation of arbitrary presumptive function by one with analytic singularities. We talk the theorem. Let phi be a presumptive function on a bounded domain omega in Cn, then the upper level set z in omega such that the number phi z greater than c as analytic subvariety of omega. Now we talk about local threshold of plurisubharmonic function. As Professor Claudio Ezezo, he talked about history of local threshold. There are many versions of definition of this in corporate analysis and also in algebraic geometry. For example, alpha invariant, alpha dn invariant, and many definitions. But here, we talk about the definition by the Debye and Kohler. We take phi. We have a plurisubharmonic function on omega of Cn, then the local threshold of phi at the point ZSO in omega is a positive Z number. C phi ZSO equals sudmum C greater than 0 such that exp to minus 2 C phi is in N1 on a neighborhood of ZSO, is an invariant number of phi. I introduce a weighted local threshold of plurisubharmonic function for every non-negative zero measure nu or the neighborhood of zero. We introduce the weighted local threshold of phi with the weight mu at zero by c mu phi z zero. It should move c greater than zero, such that e to the minus 2 c phi is n 1 mu on the neighborhood of ZSO. It means that we, if the phi have a big infinity, then the c mu phi is smaller. Now I will introduce the Martinor identity. The next it be a complex manifold, and now then introduce the I phi with a shape of homomorphic function f such that it turn over u. Modulus f to p2 is minus 2 phi less than infinity. This shape is Clausius ideal shape over it. Is the case phi z equals c divided by 2 log modulus f1 z 2 by 2 plus dot dot plus fm z 2 by 2. Where fm are Hanoi function on x, then I phi is shape of Gram Hanoi function f such that condition is come from commutative algebra. Can we also introduce what the multiple addresses? For every non-negative random matching mu on complex manifolds, we denote by in mu the sheaf germ of curves of homotopy function f such that it turns over u. Modern F to 2D mu less than infinity on some neighborhood of mu of Z in X. Now I need to talk about the notation and some design, basic design, and some motivation. Now I will talk about some recent design. Zapper, Demi, and Kohler prove fundamental design on effective version of semi-continuous theorem of local co-threshold of plurisubharmonic function as following. We take a sequence of plurisubharmonic function phi j, such that phi j converts to phi in n one log, and we assume that it turns over d e to minus 2 c phi Lebesgue measure less than infinity for some d compact in omega. Therefore, every key is compact in D, C prime less than 0 less than C. Then exists Z0 less than 1, such that supremum Z less than Z0 eaten over key, E to power minus 2 C prime 5 Z, the big measure less than infinity. This design is very deep and have many consequences in the corporate analysis and the emergency, such as constructed kind of Einstein metric on final manifolds. Then in Pham 14, I use N2 extension theorem of O square tego C for on the global basic of Martinor identity to prove the effective version of semi-continuous theorem for what the non-conical threshold. We prove this. We take the sequence of plurisubharmonic function phi j such that phi j less than phi, and phi j converts to phi in N1 log. Then we assume that integral is minus 2 C phi, modulus F 2 by 2 less than infinity. We have a modulus F 2 by 2 here. For some D is compact in omega. Therefore, if you key is compact in D, then exists Z is less than 1 such that supremum Z less than 0 iteration over key. E to per minus 2 C phi j, modulus F 2 by 2, the big measure less than infinity. Here we have the mass, the upper theorem without condition phi j less than phi is not true. In the case if we with modulus Z 1, the big measure, we see the mass 1, 3 in Pham 14. Then we have some consequences of opposed results. Demi and Kohler theorem directly implies the following consequences. Probably net is about the semi is about continuous the Meidian identity. Let's find the be a sequence of plurisubharmonic function on omega and such that phi j convert to phi in N1 log. We assume that the element 1 is in this sieve. Then for every C prime less than 0 less than C, there exists 0 less than 1, such that 1 is IC prime phi j for all j less than 0. And some of the main reason is Pham 14 and Pham 17 apply the following consequence. The next phi j be a sequence of plurisubharmonic function on omega, and phi be a plurisubharmonic function on omega, be such that phi convert to phi in N1 log. Let's do the following statement as whole. First, if we assume that phi is less than phi for every z less than 1, then for every omega prime is compact in omega, then exists z less than 1, such that e phi equal e phi z equal e phi. On omega prime for all z less than z zero. And if we assume that z1, zn is I phi zero, we don't need the assumption. We remove it. Then as it then there exists z zero less than 1 such that z1, zn is e phi z for every
dây và dàn dây dây số. And so I talk about the relationship between the local threshold and Monge-Ampère mass. With me and my paper, and myself found the inequality between local threshold and Monge-Ampère mass. Less phi in E omega, then C phi less than sum J from 1 to N, EJ minus 1 phi divided by EJ phi, where EJ phi is an iteration number, is equal iteration over J0 dz phi to J dz phi logarithm Z to N minus J. And we now we consider the C chi phi equal sub C phi S for all key dimension linear subspace S through J0. Thus, we set CK title phi equal sub C phi for all smooth sum manifold of key dimension S through J0. Then, in Pham 17, the also found the inequality between weighted local threshold. Threshold and system local threshold CK phi, we prove that for every phi is plurisubharmonic function, then CK title phi equals CK phi, because C phi with weighted is this measure. When we also phi the inequality between the system local threshold CK phi and Monge-Ampère masses, we tell them in Pham 18. You take phi in E omega, then C phi class and C M minus 1 phi plus M minus 1 tuber M minus 1 C M minus 1 phi tuber M minus 1 E N phi. And finally, I ask a question for future study. In first question about the semi-collinearity for what the local threshold, what condition on new is necessary and sufficient such that if eaten over omega prime e to plus minus 2 c phi d new less than plus infinity or some open set of omega prime in omega, then exists some data is positive number. Such that for every psi is plurisubharmonic function as a norm and one norm, psi minus phi, less than delta. Then, single psi implies single psi is greater than C. And also, if psi convert to phi in N1 omega prime, then the function e to the minus 2 c prime psi convert to e to the 2 C prime phi in N1 log degree for all C prime less than C. And I saw as a conjecture, unless phi in E omega, then C phi plus C N minus 1 phi plus E N minus 1 phi divide E N phi. And here is now some self-reference. Okay. And I finish my lecture. Thank you for attending and listening.
Are there any questions? If not, I would like to make just two final, very final concluding remarks. First of all, an event like this cannot be organized without the help of many people, and I would like to thank them, in particular the director's office, the public information office, the media office of ICTP, Mrs. Mabilo. I mean, there's really a teamwork of everybody, many, many people to have this, an event like this to happen, and I really would like to thank them publicly. I hope I haven't forgotten. I am sure I have forgotten somebody, but you know. And secondly, actually, so of course we are happy to have the Ramanujan Prize will exist in this shape. We are happy to announce it now for the next 5 years at least, because we just signed the agreement with the Indian government and the International Mathematical Union to continue in this way. And actually, just I think yesterday we opened the call for nominations for the 2020. So we move on to the next event. And of course, we would be very happy to have you again here next year around this time. It's usually earlier, but okay. So we thank and congratulate Dr. Pham again. Would you like to say a few words? Yes, I'm also wasting a little bit of your time because there is a refreshment outside the door, but I think I take responsibility. I think we said at 5, now they are running to do it as quickly as possible. It's ready. So we thank also the refreshment office. And so there is a light refreshment outside the door for everybody. Thank you.